Welcome, everyone. We're really happy to have all of you here today for this symposium organized by the Rockefeller Center here at Dartmouth. It's on a really important topic, the links between financial markets and the American economy. And we have a very distinguished panel and an incredibly distinguished moderator today. So let me just briefly introduce them, and then I'm going to turn it over to our moderator to do all the hard work. So the first panelist is Annamaria Lusardi. She's the Denit Trust Chair of Economics and Accountancy at George Washington University School of Business. She's also founder and academic director of the Global Financial Literacy Excellence Center at GW. Many of you actually may know her. She was here at Dartmouth College for about 20 years. And many people I talk to, I've only been here a year, but many people I talk to still miss her and are excited when she comes back to visit on occasions like this. She's won many awards. I won't list them all. I will just say that her work on financial literacy has been very influential in public policy for key, government agencies like the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau and international organizations, and looking forward to hearing her tell you more about that. The second panelist is Jeremy Stein. He's the Moise Safra Professor of Economics at Harvard University. He also has quite a lot of experience in the public sector. In 2009, right after the financial crisis, he was a senior advisor to the Treasury Secretary and on the staff of the National Economic Council. And from 2012 to 2014, he was on the Board of Governors of the Federal Reserve in D.C. Egon Zakrajšek is the third panelist, is a senior advisor at the Federal Reserve Board in Washington. I actually had the privilege of working together with Egon for quite a few years before I moved up here. Egon's been involved at the Fed in really crucial issues related to banking, financial markets, corporate bond markets, and financial stability issues, as well as monetary policy. And he's also taught over the years various occasions at Columbia University and Johns Hopkins. And our moderator is Peter Fisher. Many of you know him because he's a senior fellow here at the Tuck School at Dartmouth and a senior lecturer. Peter has just a stunning biography. I can only give you just a brief glimpse of it, but it starts out with a law degree from Harvard Law School. He spent a number of years at the Federal Reserve Bank of New York. At the end of that time, he was the manager of the Fed's open market account. Later, he was undersecretary of the Treasury Department for Domestic Finance. And he's worked at BlackRock Management for more than a decade. Since then, he's been a member of the board of directors of AIG. He's also on the board of the John F. Kennedy Library Foundation. And of course, as I mentioned already, he's now active in teaching here at the Tuck School. So I'm going to now turn it over to Peter and look forward to hearing from all four of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Andy. So I will try to just be a traffic cop, and I will reserve the right in a moment after our three speakers speak to pose one question to all of them to take the prerogative of the chair. I hope everyone here and the students in particular understand how important this topic is. How we think about the connection between finance and economics strikes me as still a very important work in progress. We think we know this, and yet it seems we keep learning financial crisis by financial crisis, recession by recession, that we didn't quite understand it as well as we hoped we did. So we have three terrific perspectives here. We'll go in the sequence, I guess, back across the table, Egon, Jeremy, Annamaria. They'll each speak for about 10 or 12 minutes. Andy, Levin, and I will try to keep them honest in that so that we have plenty of time for your questions. And when they're done, I'll pose one question for them to respond to sequentially, and then we'll open it up to you all. So with that, Egon, you're on.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Peter. Thank you, Andy, for this kind words of introduction. Thank you all for coming. It's a great pleasure and honor to be on a panel with both Annamaria and Jeremy. I've known them for quite some time, and they have. I feel like headlining is a very hard it's a very hard opening act. So I was asked to talk a little bit about kind of a macroprudential. I'm going to try to set up. We did coordinate a little bit, so hopefully there will be a sense that this is a symphony in three movements that actually relates to each other. There's an order to here, and I hope it will make a more compelling picture. I should also note that as a member, being on a Fed staff, there's a standard disclaimer. Everything I do say is really, really my own opinions, and in no way reflects views of any of the principals, any of the policymakers. Okay, thanks. So let me start with a little bit of a context, just to kind of set up. I think the question which we're going to be really talking about to a large extent. So I think everyone knows the financial crisis was just characterized by severe disruptions in financial markets. Credit intermediation process became severely impaired, and had really, really, really severe consequences for the real economy. Many of these effects are still felt today through kind of a labor scarring and many things. So this had really profound implications for our society. It is also not at all controversial, to say that many of the seeds for this, financial turmoil, for this crisis, were sown many, many years before the whole thing came crashing down. Right. So, there were many, many parts, many markets, financial markets, and very many institutions where things, went, wrong, and kind of culminated in that perfect storm that resulted in the biggest financial meltdown since the Great Depression. So I think that poses a really, really important question, which is, could U.S. financial regulators, and you notice that I did put the Fed first, but there's a whole soup, of financial regulators in there in the U.S. Could they have foreseen it? Could they have employed policy that more directly targeted these developing financial imbalances and vulnerabilities in the hope of maybe even preventing the full-blown financial meltdown, or at least ameliorating some of its more adverse consequences? So that's, I think, it's a really fundamental question, because things like that, financial cycles, for those of you who are familiar with the work of Carmen Reinhart and Ken Rogoff, right, these things repeat in the long tail. So it's clearly a first order policy question. The question then one would ask is, what policies should one do, right? So we know what we would call standard microprudential policies, which have been employed for many years, for decades. These are kind of the traditional role of bank and other financial regulators. Right, the key things to remember is these are designed to ensure the safety and soundness of a single institution. Okay, so bank regulators, I care about Wells Fargo, and that's it, right? And so forth. And these are kind of rationalized by your standard moral hazard arguments that levered institutions have an incentive to take on risk, which is particularly, and that is exacerbated, right, in financial institutions where there's a public safety net. Okay, so the depositors or government bailouts, bail you out. So that's kind of what's called risk shifting. Okay, so there's a really good economic reason of why these things are important. I put this in a slightly different order because another very important question, and particularly Jeremy will speak about that a little later, is that should monetary policy, and I mean both conventional interest rate and unconventional policy employing the Fed's balance sheet, should it be so-called what's called leaning against the wind? Okay, so, should we lean against the wind in a kind of a preemptive way to try to address financial imbalances? I mean, I'm certainly assuming that, monetary policy will for sure be involved in mopping up if there is a financial meltdown. Obviously, monetary policy is involved. Question here is, should we be preemptive, okay? And then the thing that I will spend most of my talk here today is what we call macroprudential policies, okay? So this is a sort of a set of policies that are getting enormous attention from policymakers across implementation in different jurisdictions, and they're designed to address systemic problems with bank and non-bank financial intermediaries, okay, as well as financial markets. And the idea here is the following, right? Ensuring that each individual institution is safe and sound is in no way sufficient that the entire financial system is safe and sound, okay? So it could be presence of market failures, the kind of externalities that give rise to systemic risk. So correlated trading, funding, hedging strategy, those type of things could be an externality which would then call for macroprudential regulation. Fire sales, the fact when everybody's trying to sell assets at the same time, right? It causes asset values to decline, right? Those kind of externalities that individual actors do not take into account. Macroprudential policies are designed to address those kinds of externalities. Interconnectedness, network externalities, particularly in the financial sector, right? Where your borrowers are also your customers, those type of things. That's the topic of macroprudential policies. The way to use a colleague of mine, Jeff Ure, who's at the Boston Fed, has a very nice description. The way he thinks of microprudential, that those are like earthquakes, okay? Earthquakes cannot be prevented, right? But structures, buildings can be built in a better way so to withstand it, right? That's what the microprudential. Macropru, and that's the term if you want to be in the crowd, you don't say macroprudential, you say macropru. Right, that's the point where it's kind of like malaria, right? Malaria cannot really be, you know, prevented, but it can be, you know, I mean, cannot be eradicated, but can be treated, okay? So that's kind of the thing that I'm gonna talk about. So structural macroprudential tools, yeah, you know, are things like that have been put in, so Basel, regulatory capital ratios, liquidity ratios, things that have been implemented after the crisis that are made to make financial system, you know, safer. There's some, you know, this comes at a cost. One certainly needs to evaluate the trade-offs, okay? High ratios have consequences. They could impair provision of credit. They can force credit intermediation into less regulated sectors, so-called regulatory arbitrage, which was a huge problem. Just to give you a sense where the U.S. is since the crisis, on the left side, you see some capital ratios. You can see from that blue region, there's been a significant increase, right? So banks, holding companies have way, way more capital to withstand losses. This is a very good thing. So system is more resilient. At the same time, what's called short-term money, this is, you know, the kind of a runnable deposit, things that are very, you know, very easily be withdrawn that makes financial institutions susceptible, you know, to funding runs, those things have declined as well. So these are things that the financial kind of structural policies have addressed to make our financial system safer, okay? The big discussion here, and this is kind of the rest of the talk, is going to talk about targeted macroprudential tools. So these are things that are targeted to specific sectors and that are often, you know, that are very much time varying. So they're applied at different points of a financial cycle. So they're targeted to sectors, most often to housing, real estate sectors, and include things like loan to value caps, debt to income caps, debt service to income caps, and so forth. There's many others, countercyclical capital buffers, stress tests, and stuff like that, okay? So targeted macroprudential tools sounds great, okay? Obviously, if they were effective, that seems to be the first kind of a line of defense one ought to use to address incipient financial vulnerabilities, but are they effective? I think the jury is still out, okay? Some yes, some no. It's a really, really very much a vibrant area of research, and much more needs to be done. Just to give you a sense, many more countries are adopting this macroprudential policy. So the index, high index means more. The green bars are post-crisis since 2013, and red are pre-crisis. So I look at this, so you can see, right? Most emerging economies tend to be, you know, more involved in using macropru, but that trend has also continued in a post-crisis in the advanced economies. So I said, assessing the efficacy of macroprudential tools is difficult, okay? The overall assessment, empirical evidence from what we have, these are small samples, okay? I would say it's mixed, okay? And not only that, often they can have some unintended consequences, okay, that we don't fully understand. Just to give you an example of how these things look up, this chart shows house prices, okay? And the way I've set this up is that for, you know, four countries. So those dates that are in parentheses tell you when did that country implement a loan-to-value cap, right? So they imposed a tighter loan-to-value cap on mortgage borrowing, okay? And the way I did it is you know, so Canada imposed a loan-to-value cap in 2008 Q3. So that is the time zero. That's that vertical line at time zero, okay? And what I did is I said, well, how they did this because house prices were growing probably too much, and they got concerned about that. So I kind of looked at deviations from the house prices to the trend, okay? So that lines on the left, the negative numbers, should be that's 20 quarters prior to the trend. These are deviations from trend. This should average out to zero, right? They went a little bit above trend, and sometimes they went a little bit around below trend, okay? Yeah, perfect. And then the line, then what I did is I extrapolated that trend for the 20 quarters after the imposition of the caps, okay? Right? Now, if these things were really, really effective, you know, in a kind of a rough sense, you would expect to see, right, that the trend, right, I assume there was the same pre-crisis trend for the 5 years after the imposition of the cap, one would expect, you know, you should see, you know, kind of the green and the red line, right? That the price is slowed below the pre-crisis trend. Well, you see that. In Canada, they did. In Sweden, they did a little bit. But in Spain, nothing, right? Even after the things, you know, the house prices continued to rise. Singapore is particular things. House prices rise. You know, it was not really about, you know, till like, you know, more than two years after the imposition of the caps that house prices turned down, right? So there's just some suggestive evidence, you know, these things do not always work, or they work with very much, you know, with long lags and so forth. So there's some implementation issue, time lags. In US, to use macro potential, we need to change regulations. There's regulatory arbitrage, right, that moves regulation outside the institutions that, you know, into shadow banking system, as well as who is in charge. How do you coordinate? We don't have an institutional body that sets like monetary policy like the Fed, you know, when it comes to financial stability. So just to wrap up here, to give you a sense, so it is very difficult to identify financial instability risks early enough to act preventively, okay? And that doesn't mean we shouldn't try, okay? Clearly making financial system as resilient as possible through capital, ample, good, high-quality capital financial institution and through rigorous stress tests is a first step. Certainly prompt implementation of effective macro-proof policies can provide an additional safeguard against financial instability. And I think the really fundamental question that is, you know, where policymakers and researchers are struggling with is whether or not monetary policy should be used to addressing, you know, financial stability concerns. Right, so Jeremy had a very influential speech in 2013. Is going to, you know, he used this wonderful phrase that, you know, monetary policy is something that gets into all the cracks. Therefore, it's good, right? It's not targeted, it gets into all the cracks. You know, that's kind of, you know, it's very effective in that sense, right? The kind of a converse argument is that linkages between policy rates, real estate prices, associated debt are very weak. So that means the kind of movements in interest rates that would require to stem house price depreciation, bring down debt ratio, may be very large, which then risk plunging the economy in a recession, the so-called collateral damage, right? How do you evaluate those trade-offs? How do you think it's you know, very much an important part of policy debate? Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks. Well, thanks very much, and it's a pleasure to be here. So, let's see. What I thought I would try to do is talk very, very quickly about some recent work by a couple of my colleagues at Harvard, Robin Greenwood and Sam Hansen. And as Egon said, this picks up really very directly from the question he posed on his last slide. So that question is, you know, I think everybody who sort of works in policy has gotten religion around the proposition you really ought to worry about financial stability. We don't want to have another one of these things anytime soon. So that's sort of, you know, the elevation of financial stability concerns is very much a consensus thing. Where there's less consensus is, yeah, but what do you do? What are the tools? So one view, and this is what Egon alluded to, one view is it's primarily a job for regulation. You basically put a bunch of rules on the banks and on other financial intermediaries to tell them to just, you know, take less risk, be more conservative, and you hope that does the job. Okay? Especially in the US financial system, you worry that if you regulate the banks, stuff is going to pop out somewhere else. It's going to pop out in some less regulated market, in the capital markets, or in other places where the regulation doesn't reach. That's led other people to say, well, maybe instead of using rules and regulation, you should try to use monetary policy, with the idea being that when interest rates are very, very low as they are today, that encourages people to borrow, to take more risk, to do what's sometimes called reach for yield, and that somehow if you kept interest rates a little bit higher, you know, that the trade-off would be maybe it's not so good for employment, but it might forestall a future crisis. So that's the sort of broad broad question. And what I'd like to do with that, and you know, neither one is perfect, obviously. With that framing, I'd like to talk about one, you know, kind of unorthodox way where I think the Fed can be a little bit helpful. And as you'll see, it's not really regulation, but it's not quite monetary policy either. It's using the Federal Reserve's balance sheet. And I'll try to explain what that means. Okay, but again, the big picture is, you know, what can the Fed do? What can the Fed do to help? And just to kind of warm this up by way of background, let me give you a sort of 1 minute thumbnail sketch of a piece of the financial crisis. You say, why did we have a financial crisis? Obviously, there are many reasons, but one of the things that went wrong is we had a lot of financial intermediaries, banks, brokerage firms like Lehman Brothers, borrowing a lot, and in particular, borrowing a lot on a very short-term basis. So like when Lehman Brothers blew up, it was basically borrowing an enormous amount overnight and having to roll over that debt essentially overnight. And as a result, if investors lose confidence, it's over very, very quickly. Okay, so one lesson learned is big, big financial institutions shouldn't get most of their money by borrowing overnight. Okay, we kind of all agree on that. That's like kind of a dangerous thing. Okay, lesson learned. Okay, what do you do? One answer is like, wait, you guys were doing that? Stop. Don't do it anymore. Okay? We're going to have a bunch of rules which basically say you're not allowed to do that anymore. Okay? And these rules have various acronyms, but they're in that spirit. You know, you should have more equity. Or at least if you're going to borrow, you should have more long-term debt. Or if you're going to have short-term debt, you better hold a bunch of cash so in case the short-term debt can't be rolled over, you have some cash as a buffer. Okay? But basically a bunch of rules which tell banks, you know, more prescriptively how to finance themselves. Okay, now, as Egon was alluding to, you know, that's all good if guys follow the rules. But this is like, it's a lot like steroids and drug testing. I mean, if everybody follows it, you know, drug testing is a great thing. If not everybody follows it, then you've got an uneven playing field. People can migrate. What's a big problem again in the US is people will migrate out of the regulated sector and you'll get a lot of this activity happening in the shadows. Okay, so there's a question about how well it works. A good question seems to me to ask is, before you stop, tell them to stop doing it, ask yourself, why were they doing so much? Why were they borrowing so much short? They could have been borrowing longer term. Things would have been better. Okay? Simple answer. It really pays. It really pays. So here is just a simple fact. For those of you who know what the yield curve is basically what is the interest rate at different maturities. On average, over the period, the pre-crisis period, 1983 to 2009, on average, it was about 60 basis points, that is to say about 0.6% cheaper if you borrowed at 1 week maturity than if you borrowed at 6 month maturity. You may say 0.6%, who cares? That's a big difference. That's a big difference for just a little bit of a shortening of maturity. So if you're a profit-seeking guy like Lehman Brothers, you're gonna push a lot of your borrowing and you're not fully taking into account the wreckage you may impose on the rest of the financial system. You're going to be awful tempted to borrow short. And if we put a bunch of rules telling you not to do it, you're going to be awful tempted to try to figure out how to circumvent those rules. So it's worth pausing. It's not that the rules are not a good idea. It's not that the rules are not a good idea, but you know, to give them a fighting chance, you don't want to necessarily pit them against such a strong economic incentive. Okay? And is there anything that you can do that sort of acts on the incentive rather than just simply sort of, you know, a rule, okay? And that's kind of our thing. So with that in place, let me show you what the Federal Reserve's balance sheet looks like, okay? So this is the Fed as of today. This is a little bit simplified, but basically is the picture, okay? The Fed is, roughly speaking, a $4.5 trillion outfit, okay? $4.5 trillion. Its assets, pretty simple. It owns about $2.5 trillion of treasury bonds, treasury securities, and about $1.8 trillion of what's called GSE. This is Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, mortgage-backed securities. Okay, so it basically owns bonds and mortgage bonds. Okay, how is it financing itself? About $1.4 trillion of that is literally its printed currency. This is, you know, the Fed prints money. It's printed about $1.4 trillion of money. That's it. The other big thing are what are called reserves. What are reserves? They're kind of similar to currency, but they're deposits that commercial banks, that Bank of America or Wells Fargo, make with the Fed. So banks have bank accounts at the Fed, and those are reserves. Okay, and then there's a little bit of other stuff. Okay, important point. This is dramatically bigger than it was before the financial crisis. So before the financial crisis, this $4.5 trillion balance sheet was about $800 billion. Okay, so it's gone up by a factor of roughly six. Okay, it was much smaller. They owned treasury securities, but much less. They printed money. That was about the same, $800 billion. They didn't have nearly so much in the way of reserves. Those were much closer to zero. Okay. Why did the balance sheet get big? This was an effort to fight the recession. In a world where they couldn't bring interest rates any lower than zero, what else could the Fed do? Basically, they bought a lot of long-term bonds to try to push interest rates on long-term bonds lower. Okay. So the balance sheet, the important point is the balance sheet got big, motivated by the asset side, motivated by their desire to buy a lot of bonds to stimulate the economy. Okay. Now, the question that has been looming is, as the economy finally recovers, as we at least begin to envision a world where interest rates may go above zero meaningfully, you know, maybe interest rates, short-term interest rates will go to 2%, something like that, does the Fed need to keep its balance sheet that big? It doesn't need to keep it that big anymore for the reasons it was originally enlarged, that is to say, to provide stimulus. So there's a lot that the general view seems to be, well, they'll shrink. They'll eventually let these bonds mature, or they'll sell them, and the Fed will go back to being a smaller and more modest thing, maybe a trillion or a trillion and a half, but certainly not $4.5 trillion. Okay? We have a somewhat contrary view, which is that the Fed may want to stay big, but no longer because you care so much about the asset side, no longer because you care so much about providing monetary stimulus, but, you know, boy, all the stuff that they're doing on the liability side, all this short-term paper, essentially, that they themselves have put in the market to raise the money for their asset side activities is useful, okay? And the essence of our argument is very, very simple, which is, there's a financial stability. Then now this is back to sort of the original thing. There is a financial stability motive, or there may be a financial stability motive for the Fed to do this. Okay? Remember my original point. On average, interest rates tend to be much lower for the very shortest maturity things, short-term, one-week treasury bills. Why? Guys like it. It's super safe. Okay? A one-week T-bill is as safe as it gets. So if you have money in a money market fund, that money market fund loves to buy things that look like one-week T-bills. Okay? Historically, the U.S. government, the Treasury Department, didn't manufacture a whole lot of one-week T-bills. Just didn't do it. They borrowed. They had some T-bills. Just to give you a sense, right now the U.S. Treasury Department has outstanding just under $400 billion of Treasury bills with maturity less than a month. $400 billion. That's small relative to the Fed, which is a few trillion. Okay. So what happens in a world, you know, basically investors love short-term safe paper. It's like, you know, it's like a bank account. It's just nice and safe. Okay. What happens if the Treasury Department doesn't satisfy that need? Private sector thinks, I can do that. I can make something that's short-term. And if I market it right and I kind of set it up right, I might convince people it's almost safe. So a lot of what was going on in the years leading up to the crisis was financial institutions doing their best to essentially, was doing their best to mimic short-term T-bills. So they were doing it. Okay. One thing you can do in this setting is try, instead of making rules against it, is to diminish their incentive by crowding them out. In other words, if the government, you know, creates a lot of short-term safe paper for investors to buy. So it's like, if you know, if the government makes a lot of hot dogs, the private sector won't make as many hot dogs because people will kind of be sick of hot dogs. Okay? Same thing with short-term paper. If the government makes a lot of short-term paper that money funds and other investors can have, then the private sector will have less incentive to do that. Okay? The Fed has effectively been doing that recently. Okay? And I'm concerned that if they pull back, what's going to happen is the private sector's incentive to do that will reemerge, and you'll get a lot of the same behavior again. Okay. The only subtlety, and this will be the last thing I say, is you might say, fine, I get it. Somebody in the government ought to really be making more short-term paper. People like short-term safe stuff. Why doesn't the Treasury, instead of issuing 300 or 400 billion of T-bills, why don't they issue 3 trillion or 4 trillion of T-bills? After all, they do have 12 or more trillion of government debt. Why don't they just shorten the maturity of that government debt? Treasury has been enormously averse to doing this. And one reason is if they have that amount of debt outstanding and every week they have to roll it over, they worry, what happens if investors don't buy our paper this week? The Treasury will run out of money. That would be a problem. It'd be very embarrassing if they couldn't roll over the Treasury. The Fed has a big advantage here. The Fed creates money. They can never get caught out. Okay? So Fed created liabilities are very similar to Treasury bills with one big difference. The Fed can never essentially have what's called a failed auction, because if somebody says, I want my money back right now, that's what the Fed does. They make the money. Okay? So they're in a sort of position, and you see, they were able to expand their supply of short-term safe stuff by several trillion without a hitch. It's just institutionally easier for them to do it than for the Treasury Department. Okay, so our basic pitch is one useful thing, and it's not, as Egon said, there's a real tension. If you try to manage this by saying I'm going to raise interest rates to get financial stability, well, then you trade that off against maybe higher unemployment. Here you have an independent tool, which is you can still keep interest rates wherever you think you should keep them to manage the unemployment problem, but as long as you're sort of a generous provider of these safe claims, I think you help diminish the incentive of financial institutions to borrow very, very short term. Not to say you should get rid of the rules, but I think this gives the rules a little bit more of a fighting chance because they won't be pitted again against such a strong economic incentive. Okay, let me stop there.
Terrific, thank you.
Great, thank you so much. I'm really delighted to be back at the Dartmouth campus and see again friends, colleagues. This has been a great day, and thank you both Andy and Andrew Samwick for inviting me. What I would like to do actually is also talk about another side of the economy, which is the household sector. And these are the people that, you know, if the banks fails, where actually we had people who took up mortgages that they were not able to afford, and there were very severe consequences, of course, of the financial crisis and the Great Recession. So I would also like to put in perspective all of these, in a sense, macroprudential that we put in there. We want a stable financial system, but have family as a result become more stable, and are they doing better? I could have used the word stability, but instead I'm going to use the word financial fragility. This is actually one measure that we have adopted in a new survey, and I'll make clear in a moment what we are talking about. In a sense, we do want regulations at the end to make our life better. And that's an important purpose also of monetary policy. I teach personal finance now, and I just realized, you know, that of all of the part of the public policy, probably the central bank is the most important for households just because of the interest rate and the inflation. It's going to be hard in 12 minutes to tell you a lot of indicators for households, so I'm only going to choose one. And it's the one that we have been working on with a regulator that was not listed in the set of regulators mentioned by Egon, but this is the FINRA, which actually regulates the financial markets. Started in 2009 after the financial crisis, a new survey has been designed to try to assess, in a sense, the balance sheets and the situation of the households. And we have called this financial capability. And this is actually consistent with a lot of other surveys in other countries. We actually have been one of the academic advisors for the beginning in 2009. I work at the US Treasury to actually write the report for the first financial capability, and on July 12, we issued the third wave, and we actually hosted the release of the wave, of this third wave at GW, at GFLAC, and we had all the regulator come and kind of discuss how our family doing, you know, several years after the financial crisis. So I'm going to only tell you a measure of all of this survey, which has a lot of information, and is called financial fragility. We designed this measure in 2009 together with Peter Tufano. I was visiting HBS at that time, and after the financial crisis, we wanted to assess how our family doing, and we did it with this particular question. Let me actually pin it down, and I'll tell you in a moment what this, why this measure is so versatile. It sort of gives this capacity of household to be able to face a shock. So here we are thinking of a moderate type shock, $2,000. And we want to see what is the confidence. So we are also looking at this self-assessment of the household to be able to face a shock, and not immediately, but in 30 days. So there are these three components of this question. And the reason why it is versatile is actually measure not just your debt situation, but your asset situation as well. And just for brevity, I'm just going to define as somebody being financially fragile, if they certainly cannot come up with $2,000, or they feel they might not be able to come up with this $2,000 in 30 days. So just to show you, I don't have a lot of time to explain what this measure does. It's actually a very simple indicator, but it's actually a better predictor than household wealth or actually debt position. And let me give you a few statistics about this. When we combine this data, we had asked this question originally in this TNS, global economic crisis, and more or less in 2009, half of the population could not come up with $2,000 in 30 days. Right? And I hope you can try to think of, you know, from these data, the stories of what this actually meant. It really meant that people, if the car broke down, they couldn't go to work. If the child needed braces, they couldn't afford the expense, and so on. And so, you know, you can actually think of the kind of pain behind, in a sense, the number. The data shows how much better the economy is doing several years after the financial crisis. In 2015, a third of the population cannot come up with $2,000 in 30 days. Let me show you that this also aggregate statistics hide wide differences across households. So for example, if you look at the millennial, and I put this picture up because of all of you young people, actually the millennials are much more financially fragile. If I were to restrict to the young people which are here, of course, this measure would be much, much higher. But in a sense, financial fragility persists even late in the 20s. So you know, it takes several years, in a sense, for people to be financially stable. Another group, certainly very financially fragile, are the African Americans. I read a lot about what Andy writes, and here is certainly a group which has kind of suffered a lot from the recession and is still certainly not very financially stable yet. And I also want to mention income, because clearly there is a very clear gradient with income, but actually, you know, the middle class, or what is considered the middle class, if you look at, for example, just the group around the median of $50,000, actually we see a high proportion who is financially fragile. And in fact, if I look at people who are 50,000 to 100,000 in kind of in the working year, so from 25 to 60, you know, one in four cannot afford, in a sense, an expense of $2,000 in 30 days. And of course, I could not mention financial literacy. You know, in a sense, a lot of households now are facing much more complex financial markets and much more complex financial instruments. But in fact, when you ask them about these very basic principles like interest compounding, inflation, or risk diversification, actually many of them are really not knowledgeable about those, and those who are less knowledgeable are also less able, or less likely to be financially stable. So, you know, finance has become very, very important in our daily life, yet people do not seem to have the tools or the skill to actually manage their finances also well. In 2013, the Fed started a new survey, which is called SHED, or Household Economics and Decision Making. And so, you know, finally now, in addition to the survey consumer finances, where you do look at the value of wealth and debt, now we also have a survey very similar to the survey with the regulator, where they can understand a little better, in a sense, how households are doing and how are they making financial decisions. It has been conducted yearly since 2013, and just this last May, they issued the 2015 data. So what they ask is a very similar question like our question, but they did it differently, which is, well, you know, let's not give, in a sense, this 30 days definition and this mid-sized shock. They actually ask whether household, how they would be able to pay for an hypothetical expense of $400 now. Right, so it's actually quite equivalent or similar to some of our questions, but with the idea of asking, do you have, in a sense, the capacity to face today a shock of $400? Okay, and 46% actually of the population said they would have a lot of difficulties facing this $400 expense. You know, I actually spend a lot of time looking at the data and describing the data, and we have written, you know, this very long report and these short briefs as well, but we couldn't, I think, quite get this data circulated or this story really be told until last spring, The Atlantic picked it up. And actually really made this data and this statistic a story. And Neil Gabler, which is the author who wrote this story, was such a maverick writer because he literally took the data and make it a story, which is his story. And he says, I am one of these people. I cannot face an expense of $400. I really don't know how to manage my finances is very, very complex, and I feel very financially fragile, and I feel, you know, that for me this is a very difficult situation. So we have started ourselves try to get the data and try to hear more the stories from this data, and we have started a more qualitative work on try to understand, indeed, what does this mean for the family, for the individual? What does, in a sense, financial fragility really mean? Believe me, for a macro person, this is a hard project to do, but it's actually a really exciting project because we need to have a perspective of what this means. And these stories, I think, are incredibly important. Several years after the recessions, you know, the regulations might be doing better, but certainly a lot of families have not recovered, and there is, I think, a lot of pain in the economy, which might be reflecting also in this political debate. And one of the questions I would like to ask, perhaps in a different way here, is almost like being the doctor rather than the regulator, is, but can we do prevention? And perhaps it is the same questions, but you know, regulators are often not ahead of the curve, and instead, like we do it for medicine and for health, can we instead do prevention rather than regulate, or rather than kind of pay the cost of the crisis? It seems that it's going to be cheaper and potentially less expensive and less painful. So let me end with a question. It's probably never good to end with a question, but I hope that when we think of public policy, we are also thinking of the household, because that's us.
Thank you. Thank you all very much. I'm going to try to ask one question to try to pull it together, and maybe it's a pushy question, but forgive me. I'd like you each to imagine the possibility that the pessimists are right, which is we've been in a 30-year decline in productivity, and it's going to continue, and we're going to end up like Japan with a potential growth rate of 0.5% a year, which is what they're down to. So the pessimists are right. We had a little blip up in potential growth in the late 90s, but here we are. This is the road we're on. And against that backdrop, another pessimistic thought is, so what's monetary policy been doing for the last 30 years? It's been pushing up debt to income to fill that gap. And we've saw debt to income rise up right until the edge of the crisis. It's improved a little bit, depending on the measure, not very much. At best, back to where we were in the 80s, but other measures show it pretty depressing. So that's the backdrop against what I want to ask you each a question. Egon, if that's what's been going on, how can financial stability, macroprudential policy pick up the pieces if monetary policy is forever pushing the limit of debt to income? That's your question. Jeremy, your question is going to be, everyone gets a little chance to think.
Good. No freelancing.
After 500 years of capitalism, you've concluded that maturity transformation that banks do of borrowing short and lending long is too risky for anyone but the government to do. Mm-hmm. Is that really what we're left with? can we raise poor people up with debt against the backdrop of what if the pessimists are right? What should we be doing to the liability side of the bottom half of the income's distribution balance sheet? Should it have a lot of debt on it? So let me ask you each, and then I'll open it up. So there you go. Egon, you're on first.
So I would say I think I'm not a pessimist, so I actually
that's okay, but I asked you to imagine the pessimists
right.
are right.
Right, so the definition, right, of a optimist is a poorly informed pessimist. So I think this, you know, it is, I mean, it's a very valid scenario. I mean, it doesn't even have to be so incredibly dire in a sense of Japan. You know, interest rates, even if you think of like what we think of now, return to normal, right, the return to whatever kind of if you look at a, you know, summary of economic projection, the Fed, the kind of the long run equilibrium federal funds rate is only, you know, it's below 2%, depending on how you look at it. So we're going to be in an environment of low interest rates if we return back to kind of steady state, which means if a big financial shock hits, right, there's very little room, you know, to cut interest rates. So monetary policy is limited. But to your point, I mean, you know, this is exactly the thing, right, that the low interest rates, as Jeremy point, can, you know, inducing reaching for yield, further levering up, and you have financial fragility, you mop up by lowering interest rates, and the cycle starts again. That's what, you know, sensible macroprudential regulation can address. The goals, I think the point here is that, you know, the focus of macroprudential regulation works at a slightly different horizon than monetary policy, which is primarily concerned for the business cycle. The kind of financial credit cycle is a little bit of a longer stuff, right? So separating those things, you know, and giving, you know, in treating them, understanding their complementarities, you know, would be the right thing. But certainly seeing something that we should be doing.
Thanks.
Okay. 500 years of capitalism. Okay, so the question was whether, so banks and other financial intermediaries do something called maturity transformation, which is basically buying relatively long or illiquid assets, but financing with things like deposits, which are very short term and which can be removed. Okay, and Peter was asking whether I've concluded that this is too risky for the private sector to do, so the government should take it over. And the answer, no, of course not. The question is just whether the government tries to take a little bit of the edge off. In other words, I think what many of us concluded from the financial crisis, not that you shouldn't have banks, not that you shouldn't have maturity transformation, but their private incentives to really push things to the limit and be, let's say, 90-some percent financed with short-term debt, maybe a little bit more than you would like, maybe you'd prefer them to be 80% short. and can the government help? And just to put things in sort of some quantitative perspective, you know, the liabilities of U.S. banks, broad ballpark, like $10 trillion. The liabilities of foreign banks operating in dollars, another broad ballpark, $10 trillion. So if I'm thinking of the Fed or the Treasury putting another couple of trillion in to take a little bit of the edge off, it's to sort of be a complement to the regulation. That's, again, to seeking to do the same thing, make them a little bit less aggressive. Certainly nowhere close to trying to displace bank. We've all got the same objective, is that their capital structure be not 98% short-term debt, but something a little bit less.
Great, thanks. My tough question.
This is a great question because it allows me to say more, also what we see in the data, which is that, you know, if you look at the balance sheet and out of the families, you know, we see they carry a lot of debt. And actually, interestingly, we just did a study across cohorts. And so now they carry a lot of debt, like not just close to retirement, but into retirement. So, you know, we are in a situation where debt has become, you know, part of the life cycle, you know, for a long time. And our retirement has to do a lot about servicing debt, not just, in a sense, decreasing wealth. Some of the things that worries me is that, in particularly for a lot of the family and the lower income, lower education, lower financial literacy family, there is a lot of debt that charges higher interest rate. For example, not just credit card, but alternative financial services. And so, you know, this is the type of debt that, you know, can easily and because of the interest rate bring people to be even more financially fragile or put them on the edge. And it's actually striking to see, you know, one of the surprising, actually, part of this survey was just how some of these methods of borrowing are not fringes. They are used by a large proportion of the population. So that is very, very important for household, and it could be a threat.
All right, thank you. Now, your opportunity. Let me ask you to briefly identify yourself, ever so briefly, and pose a question. So, sir, did you have a question? Jump in. Stand up and speak clearly so we can all hear you.
Also, please wait.
Oh, here comes the mic coming down. We do. All right.
Hi, I'm James Chartouni, Dartmouth 19. So this question is directed to Professor Stein. What is the source of that safe asset shortage? Is it regulatory, so Basel III and new capital requirements by banks, secular growth, so that developing countries are creating mature financial systems, but they're not supplying sufficient safe assets, or is it just insufficient and chronic aggregate demand shortages? Thank you.
So it's a great question, and one reason it's a great question is because where you come down on that will affect sort of how you think about policy. So, you know, I've been sort of carelessly talking about it as if all this safe asset demand is legitimate in the sense that somebody should be trying to accommodate the demand. It's like, you know, people who want the hot dogs, we should just find a way to make the hot dogs, whether it's the private sector or the public, but we shouldn't question why there's demand for 10 trillion hot dogs, okay? And, you know, to your point, some of this demand is probably demand we don't feel great about. So as there are many, many sources, but just to give you one example, corporations, this is non-financial corporations, Apple, Google, those guys, their holdings of cash have gone up and up to the point where there's, you know, hundreds of billions of dollars in a handful of the biggest non-financial corporations. And for many of them, they could in principle have it in a variety of financial assets, but it's awful simple to manage. You can hire one person and say, don't screw up, put it in something safe. So a lot of the demand, for money market funds comes from what are called institutional prime funds. These are funds that cater to corporations. And then that in turn could be related, for example, I mean, this is just a small piece of it, you know, there are tax rules that make it very unattractive for companies that have earned a lot of profit overseas to repatriate those profits here. So sort of the money stays trapped in the corporation, and then they have to find a place to put it. So I think at least some piece of the safe asset demand could come from that. And then to your point, maybe the right policy is not to tie ourselves in knots trying to accommodate it, but to figure out a way to make the companies disgorge the cash, so maybe there's not so much demand. Okay, so that's one example, but I think the broader point, again, is a very important one, that you want to think about where the demand is coming from rather than just take the view that we've implicitly been taking of, you know, let's do what we can to kind of make something available for it.
Okay, here, yeah, mm-hmm. Here comes the mic.
Rick Ailey, I'm a member of the Hanover community. None of you have touched on fiscal policy, and I guess my question for each of you is there a role for fiscal policy in any of this? And I have in mind, as I ask it, two different things. First, at the time of the financial crisis, some commenters said that Germany was hit less hard because they had a social safety net that in effect was counter-cyclical. That would certainly address, for example, households in crisis. It might derivatively address some macroprudential concerns. More recently, you see at least some academic discussions of guaranteed minimum income, which might have some of the same impact.
Panel, anyone wants to jump in?
So, you know, even though I am European, I think, you know, this guaranteed income is a hard beast to address, and, you know, several countries has also voted against it, even in Europe. But I have to say, you know, you have a really great point about, I think, you know, more safety net. And I think a lot of the fiscal policy we do looks, for example, at financial stability in the long run. So we have a lot of tax incentive for retirement savings. But how about, you know, other savings? And in fact, you know, there can be even a disincentive to kind of for the poor to save because you sort of are taxed on your savings. And so I think there is a role for policy, and I think there is a role for fiscal policy, and there is a role, I think, for providing, I think, a better safety net, a better insurance for households.
Jeremy, how would you jump in? It's a good question.
So, yeah, great question. If Peter had asked me the dystopian question about, you know, zero productivity and all that, I would have answered, my answer would have been fiscal policy, in the sense that, you know, in this world where sort of the natural interest rate is very, very low, and monetary policy, even if it's a little bit effective, which you've got to question whether it can be effective at zero for a very, very long time, even if it is, it comes with a bunch of collateral costs, risk-taking. The obvious answer is to try to, is to have a situation where monetary policy not asked to carry all the weight, and that argues for something fiscal. And by the way, you can make that argument even if you're not trying to make a standard Keynesian argument, even if you're not making an argument about safety net or redistribution, even you're just trying to do good capital budgeting from a public right. sector perspective, which is, you know, infrastructure stuff has got to get done when the real rate of interest is zero, or yeah, maybe below zero. When you do your NPV calculations, like more stuff comes up positive NPV, and you can lock in basically those rates for a very long period of time. So I think that argument is pretty compelling, and basically it's hard not to give it sort of serious attention.
You going to want to add, or
no? I think that's.
I mean, I think it's the seminal question, really, of the moment for the world. Your question, and I think that we in this country, especially. Have lost sight of a dynamic role for fiscal policy, given our politics.
Actually, can I just add one thing? An interesting question for people who sit in a central bank. I think central bankers, because of sort of their guarding of their independence and other have been a little loath to say things like, guys, we're kind of done here. Exactly. We're out of ammunition. You know, you have to take the next step. That's a very hard thing. And you've seen Janet Yellen, for example, really stretched to say, oh, we could handle another recession with monetary policy, to a point where it feels, at least in my view, a little bit outside the bounds of plausible, because it's just a very uncomfortable thing for a central banker to say. At some point, maybe we'll get there soon, they'll have to make the judgment about whether they're willing to take a little bit of risk and be somewhat more public with something like that. I think in Peter's scenario, at some point, that question has to get.
And I'll flip it very briefly to say, I think 35 years ago when I was coming up, a lot of people understood in Washington that our finance minister in this country was someone called the chairman of the House Ways and Means Committee. That person was really seminal in the mix of taxes and spending that our government undertook. And it's really been lost. You know, we sort of, that's been obscured. And I think that's part of the problem. Anyway, that's a great question. Yeah. Other questions here
and
in the very back.
To his credit,
row.
Mario Draghi has tried to say that exactly. A little stronger.
Anyway, in the very back, microphone.
My name's Jordan. I'm a senior at the college. And I think just going off the earlier question, I think this is intended mostly for Egon. if there were to be, obviously right now, the focus of the Fed, my understanding is the expectation that at some point, Jan, probably later this year or next year, whenever, is going to announce a rise, however big that might be, in interest rates. If new data comes out not as strong, not as positive, and is a lot more negative than expected, have there been conversations for a worst case scenario, given that nations like Japan have already dropped into the negative territory, that could potentially happen in the US as well?
All right, so let's see. To be kind of a little careful, I might end up. I think I would look good in orange.
We'll repeat the your statement that you don't express the views of the board.
You know, I think, yeah, that's obviously a very delicate question, but let me kind of reframe that, right? What is kind of the fundamental things that central bankers do, right? Very much of it is risk management, right? It's about risk management, right? Inherently, monetary policy is forward-looking. It relies on forecast projections, on the path of uncertain variables, things that we have very, very little certainty. We know there's a lot of uncertainty about those things, right? So, you know, part of any kind of a, you know, deliberation about monetary policy is precisely to think about those, tail scenarios, right? Whatever it is, dip, you know, what is the configuration of things that could happen that could push the economy away from its recovery towards, you know, full potential, as well as, you know, things that maybe we've missed. Maybe the recovery is perhaps stronger and there's more incipient inflation pressure, stuff like that, right? That's a responsible thing to do. So, without like dodging, engaging in, any more speculation, it is, there's a lot of that going on, and that's, the crucial part. But again, these are, we're obviously operating, just if you think intellectually, the kind of, models, the frameworks that we have, Japan is an interesting experience, but you can't map everything from Japan, to the United States. So I'll leave it at that.
Sorry, over in the back row, over here. I'm sorry, right there.
Hello, my name is Tim Fisher. I'm from Lyme, and I've been doing some studying and reading a lot of Professor Lusardi's work on financial literacy and financial education. So naturally, my question for you is, one of the statistics you shared was that 44% of the country has difficulty with some of the basic financial concepts. So we have the government and the Federal Reserve and a lot of people working on it from the top-down problems, but from the bottom up, where do you see financial education and financial literacy dealing with the public that is struggling so much with some of the very basic lack of financial literacy?
Thank you for this question. Thank you for this question. So I really do think, institutions play a very important role, but we, individuals are dealing with decisions that were not there in the past. And in particular, looking at this audience, like student loan, with 1.3 trillion of student loan in the hand of young people, think of the danger, speaking of stability. So I really do think that there is an important role for kind of financial literacy. And I don't want to argue that, it's going to be the solution to, any problem or the solution, but, in a sense, we need new skills in the 21st century because we are just dealing with decisions that weren't there in the past. So, I really think it's incredibly important to start in the school. And each year we delay not having financial literacy in the school. We leave out a generation who basically doesn't have, these skills. It is as if, they are not able to use the computer or speak a foreign language or something like this. So, and the OECD as well has mentioned and added financial literacy in the skills that young people need to have today to participate to society. But of course, out of the school system, I think there is an important role, for example, for the employer, because also at the employer, now workers have to make many decisions, for example, about their pension, but even the new health contracts we were discussing yesterday have a really financial component. So I think there are ways in which, we can add financial education effectively in what people do, so they are better able to confront this very complex financial environment. Regulators are really doing a lot to perhaps make the system more stable, but individuals as well, I think, have to do a lot for their own financial stability. Thank you for that question.
Mm-hmm. Yes, here in the dark shirt, there.
I'm Billy, I'm a sophomore here. So I'll kind of start this line of questioning just by saying I'm surrounded by a lot of gold bugs, so I'm not trying to sound overly pessimistic, but I guess I'm exposed to some thinking that many people aren't. And so I'd start by asking, since about 2011 or so when gold was at an all-time high, all asset classes have seen a good bit of inflation except commodities, so what's your outlook on that? And then secondly, does the stock market really reflect the soundness of the U.S. economy? And I guess to that point, is everything overvalued right now? And then finally, is the economy really strong enough for a raise hike?
There were three questions. So why don't you each take whichever one of those you want?
Okay. Wow. Okay. So I'm not an expert on commodity prices, but sort of my understanding is that the price of commodities is very, very much driven by so supply and demand, right? So gold is really, I think, fundamentally an industrial commodity, and it doesn't really, really, really reflect the kind of links with inflation or inflation expectations. I once saw a study, which I'm not sure remember, which sort of showed that over long periods, really, gold price fluctuations in the price of gold were very much correlated with how well the Indian economy was doing. It's not a perfect correlation, and culturally, giving jewelry at weddings and things like that is a big part of the culture. And when Indian economy is doing well, the gifts get more lavish and things like that. So that had enough of an influence, on a price of a gold that it's a boost of demand. What was the other?
Right. Jeremy gets asked. Jeremy gets the question. We'll divide and conquer.
Okay. Let me try to say, you asked about other asset prices and valuations generally. Let me, rather than trying to cover the whole thing, let me use commercial real estate just as an example, because Eric Rosengren, who's the president of the Federal Reserve Bank of Boston, actually has been pretty public saying he's concerned about valuations in commercial real estate. And he happened to come to Harvard to give a talk the other day, so I listened to his talk, and I'll tell you what I sort of had as an impression. So if you plot the prices of commercial real estate, what's sometimes called the cap rates, which is essentially like a price earnings ratio for commercial real estate, okay? Those price earnings ratios have been going up. So in that sort of simple sense, commercial real estate looks like it's becoming sort of more expensive. Okay, then somebody said, "Well, yeah, but isn't that just because interest rates are very low?" Okay, and sure enough, if you plot this alongside the yield on 10-year bonds, they're moving pretty much in lockstep. So a benign interpretation would be, well, any asset that's sort of a long-lived asset, you're supposed to discount it, and when rates are lower, when real rates are lower, that discounted valuation will be higher. And so maybe that's the rational price. Okay, slightly more worried spin on that would be, that's true, but what's happened is the so-called duration of all these assets, that is to say, their sensitivity to a given movement in interest rates, has gone up, simply because interest rates are so low. So it may be sort of right given where bonds are today, but then if this comes to the last part of your question, if the Fed does something that somehow spooks the bond market, you might be worried that a lot of these other assets, be it commercial real estate or the stock market, are going to be more sensitive than they usually would be to a movement. So I think in that sense, I'm sort of always very reluctant to make a call that prices are too high or too low, but I think you might reasonably say that they might be expected to be sensitive to certain kind of shocks, and maybe a little more so. And in his particular case, commercial real estate, he made the nice observation that a very large share of this commercial real estate is sitting on the balance sheets of relatively small banks. So you might ask yourself, that would at least lead you to ask yourself a series of questions about, is their risk management sort of, up to par? Do they understand the interest rate exposure of the assets that they're holding? I think those sorts of risks are pretty worth thinking about.
And that was, it appears that was the basis of his dissent at the most recent Fed meeting.
Yeah, he was a little careful to sort of, I think he couched it some about kind of worries about inflation,
right,
and some but he's certainly been quite vocal about the commercial real estate sector.
Mm-hmm. And just to piggyback a little bit, and the history on that, the historical experience of that does not go into our favor.
Yeah.
In the mid 1990s, there was, I think, particularly very similar phenomenon where, commercial real estate prices rose. I think the Fed started tightening, monetary policy, and there was, very, very big disruptions in this that affected banks. And it is particularly true that, commercial real estate lending now for a long time has very, very much been the kind of a business that small, medium-sized banks do. In one sense, most of those institutions, are not in any way systemically important and stuff like that, but they're very, very important for local communities, right? Banking is a very, very local thing, and it can have, very large, localized adverse economic effects. So it's definitely a first order, business. But I would also say that that's something that, regulators are very, very good, and that's the kind of microprudential policies that ensure the safety and soundness of individual institutions where those things can be quite effective, right? So regulators go into those banks, you can look at their exposure, you see how much capital, and they can just say, you know what, you got to stop that, you got to build up your capital and stuff like that. So that there are mechanisms in play that can, do that. Now, they're not always effective, as we know, but, at least there are some mechanisms.
Okay, another question? Yes, ma'am, in the striped shirt.
Hi, I'm McLean. I'm a senior at Dartmouth, and my question relates to Professor Stein's proposal. I was thinking while you were presenting that the Fed has a lot of long-term assets, and if your proposed program were implemented on a large scale, and if the Fed raised interest rates, the Fed could end up with negative carry, and I'm curious whether you think that any central bank, the Fed or the BOE, or any G10 central bank could get away with that politically?
So that is a really good question. And one thing I didn't get to in this presentation, but it's completely motivated by your point, which is a slightly broader version of your question. It's not only negative carry, but if the Fed has a large balance sheet and is holding relatively long-term assets, then it's effectively taking fiscal risk on behalf of the government, because if interest rates go up, it will lose money or make money. And there's a question of whether that's appropriate for the Fed to do. Now, they've done that sort of under extreme circumstances. When interest rates were at zero, they had no choice, arguably, to stimulate the economy. You might say, and I think there's a very strong consensus, that once interest rates go back up and the Fed doesn't need to take that kind of carry risk, it's better that they not. Okay, so those who want to see the balance sheet shrink are effectively making your argument. So in deference to that argument, which I think, it's how bad the political fallout would be is hard to say, but I think you are taking some political risk and risking the Fed's independence by having this big thing. One thing we suggest in our paper is that, because now what you care about is not the asset side of the balance sheet, it's just having enough safe stuff out there. It turns out you can take a $4.5 trillion balance sheet. Right now, the Fed's bonds that it owns have an average maturity of about 8.5 years. Okay? That creates a lot of this risk because they're holding very long-term bonds. There are enough Treasury bonds out there, basically, that the Fed could keep its size at $4.5 trillion, but buy much shorter maturity bonds, let's say with an average maturity of 2 or 3 years. Now its mismatch would be much smaller, and its fiscal footprint and its carry risk would be much smaller, and yet it would still be putting $4.5 trillion of safe stuff into the economy. So our argument is there's sort of two ways to shrink the Fed's fiscal footprint. One is to just shrink everything down. The other is to keep the balance sheet bigger, but in sort of in deference to your argument, to have shorter maturity assets. And we've done a bunch of calculations which basically say you can get rid of, not all of, but you can get rid of a substantial amount of the sort of risk that you're referring to by holding shorter maturity. So we would prefer to go that route first rather than outright shrinking.
I'm going to riff on your question and ask Jeremy a question, which is, first I'd point out there are a couple of small central banks that have run negative equity in the last few years, we say politely, but it really would be quite a different thing for the US dollar to a central bank to be running negative equity. That might be an experiment we don't want to run. In deference to that, yeah. I want to ask you whether you've thought about the contrast between your ideas and those that John Cochran's been writing about for the last couple of years. He would retool the Treasury's offering, and yes. my job at the Treasury was debt management. Yes. So to simplify it a little bit, so everyone can get in the spirit of this, he imagines the Treasury just issuing two instruments, mm-hmm. both of them perpetuities. Mm-hmm. One would be a floating rate, which would mimic Treasury bills, mm-hmm. but you'd never have to have an auction to roll it over. Yes. And the other would be a fixed rate, a fixed coupon, which would be more like the classic British console perpetuities, which would emulate the long bond. And then the Treasury can issue those in whatever amounts it wants, and if it wants to contract the supply, it buys them back. It puts fiscal risk on the fiscal where it belongs and not on the Fed's balance sheet. Are there, compare and contrast your ideas with John's.
I think you want to. I want to start by saying they're basically all trying to get at the same problem mm-hmm. and trying to sort of act within existing authority to get as close to you know to win. So I like the floater idea. In some sense, what are reserves that pay interest? They're like perpetual floaters. In other words, the Fed doesn't have to worry about rolling them over, and they bear a short-term rate of interest. So we're both trying to do the same thing. And then the question is, do you end up lodging the decision in the Treasury Department where it sort of belongs, or in an independent central bank where it sits a little less comfortably? The Treasury does have floaters now. Interestingly, the market doesn't seem yet to have fully embraced them in the sense that they float relative to the interest rate on 13-week bills, but they cost the Treasury about 10 or 12 basis points more. I guess the market somehow thinks they're a little less liquid or something. But that aside, that would be one way to go. Another scheme that you could do is have the Treasury issue conventional bills. Let's say they actually issued $2 or $3 trillion of T-bills. But because they're worried about rollover risk, they kept a bank account of $2 or $3 trillion of cash at the Fed, so that if an auction went wrong, they'd still have the cash. Now notice, in that version, you would again be expanding the Fed's balance sheet. Mm-hmm. But you'd be saying, well, the Fed isn't really doing it themselves. They're just acting as an agent for the Treasury. Right? They're just renting out their service as the money creator to the Treasury, but it's Treasury's decision. And then again, that might sort of solve the political economy problem. It runs right now under existing law into sort of debt ceiling kinds of issues, but that might be another way to go. So I think this is exactly the right way to frame it. The big picture thing is you want somebody in the US government, be it the Treasury or the Fed, to provide a lot more short-term safe stuff, and then you start working within kind of institutional and political economy constraints.
Mm-hmm. Other questions? Here. Yes, sir, in the middle.
Yeah, I'm Vibor. I'm a sophomore here at the college. So I had a question for you, Professor Stein. So Citadel, which is Ken Griffin's hedge fund, they have a risk management program where they match their asset maturities with their debt maturities. So if they think they have an investment that might last for 10 years, they take out a 10-year T-bill or something like that. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But like a 10-year bond, basically. Mm-hmm. So, and hedge funds should be a place where regulatory arbitrage, that's the end point of regulatory arbitrage from banks, right? So mm-hmm. why do you think it is that, what do you think the differences are between the incentive systems of a hedge fund and a bank, which to me seem pretty similar? Like that makes it so that this hedge fund has that sort of risk management program and chooses to forgo the potential profits from having maturity transformation.
It's a good question. So I can't speak to Citadel in particular because I don't know exactly. I suspect, without knowing, that they also do a lot of short-term funding. But I don't know. I don't know. And you know, if you look at hedge funds in general, part of what they do is this sort of carry trade, is whether it's with Treasury securities that they own and then finance on a short-term basis or with other things, that's been part of what they've done for a long time. And you know, these things ebb and flow. So for example, the previous time, much, much smaller little financial shenanigans were 97, 98, long-term capital management, which was a hedge fund, was extremely levered and doing exactly this kind of intermediate, you know, billion dollars of assets with basically mostly short-term funding. After that, it's interesting, you know, a lot of regulatory attention was on the hedge funds as this thing, and less was on some of the broker-dealer firms and others. So what you always worry about, whatever things look like right now. The other thing is right now the yield curve is very flat because it's been, What I sort of worry about is when monetary policy normalizes and there's all this regulation preventing it from happening in the banking sector, it's going to want to migrate somewhere. Now, whether it's a hedge fund or some other vehicle is a little harder to say, but you put these basic gravitational forces in play and you sort of suspect it's going to pop up somewhere.
If I could embellish your answer, having run fixed income at BlackRock for a few years, and again, I don't know the specifics of Citadel, I think there are a number of hedge funds that are run where you try not to let the trader earn the carry spread.
Right.
That is, that they should be doing some other arbitrage, mm-hmm. and so you set up the funding of it so that they don't get to capture and sort of sneak under the rug, if you will, a carry trade. They're supposed to be doing some arbitrage that's cleverer than that. Now, whether as an aggregate the firm is actually not borrowing a lot short, there are probably a lot of short-term trading strategies that are just trying to capture little arbitrages that come up day by day. So guess what? That's all borrowed short, right, to Jeremy's point. But I think that would be a thesis of why you would try as a risk management structure to run a hedge fund that way, because if the guy running the hedge fund on the top wants to catch a carry trade, he knows how to do that. He's hiring everyone else to do something a little cleverer. Anyway. Yes, Andy. Microphone here in front. Mm-hmm.
So as the organizer, I'll take the privilege of asking a question. There was news lately about Wells Fargo, and there's been news just in the last several days, Dan Tarullo, who's kind of the key person at the Federal Reserve Board in, you know, financial stability and supervision, has talked now about the possibility that banks are too large, mm-hmm. and that they may need to be broken up. He's, you know, described it as sort of, well, in the end, of course, it'll be their own choice, but the truth is how they're supervised and regulated will significantly influence this. And so I'm just curious from all three of you, I mean, both thinking about this from this consumer and communities, as Egon mentioned, you know, there was this idea that large banks have big increasing returns and they need to compete with, you know, international financial institutions around the world. And another view, which is, you know, maybe these banks are too big and too complex and too risky, and it's time, you know, to go to a simpler system. So I'm just curious if any of you would like to comment on this.
So, I now really emphasize these are my own personal views. I really mean that. These are very, very much my own personal views. I think they are. I think there's even, you know, kind of a rigorous academic, you know, industrial organization studies evidence that looks at this stuff, and you know, you are unable to find any economies of scale at the level of these financial behemoths. There is just you know, the economies of scale are exhausted and much. So these are way, way bigger, and there's a strong incentive for them to get bigger, right? Once you get into that too big to fail territory, it is, you know, you've kind of made it. You can take on risks and things like that. The other thing is, you know, also how did these things get, how did a lot of these banks get very big, okay? A lot of it is not organic growth. It's literally just through mergers and acquisitions, okay? They just buy and gobbling up others. A massive, massive consolidation in the banking industries, right? We went from, let's say, early 1990s from having, you know, I don't know, 15,000-16,000 banks, you know, now to having like, you know, 6,000 banks, right? It's been huge, huge consolidation. When they grow, when these banks grow, when they consolidate, is, you know, integrating a bank that you bought into your business line is costly, okay? In financial crisis, most of these banks were unable to provide the regulators with their basic statistics, like how much subprime exposure do you have? Oh, we don't know, you know, it's in some other bank, they have a different computer system. Wait, you bought this bank 10 years ago, you still haven't integrated? You know, that's cost. Nobody wants to buy up costs, right? So it was just, you know, they're just run, they're huge, they're not very well integrated. So I do think they're too big, they're not complex, they don't seem to be generating, you know, any kind of economies of scale. So how do you do it? You break them up? Do you impose, you know, very nonlinear capital charges that are a function of size of assets? So when these things get bagged, they just say, yo, well, you know, you want to be that big, we're going to make it really, really costly for you. You're just going to have huge, huge amounts of capital. So you try to incentivize them, let them find their own optimal thing. But I think that is a big issue.
Okay. I want to press you and others can jump in. I understand that argument that you've made, but let me offer some contrafactoids. Mm-hmm. One is, two of the countries that had better financial crises are Canada and Australia.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
We've got much more concentrated banking Absolutely. Systems than we have, way more concentrated. Yep. We 6,000 banks, we look sort of wild.
Wild.
Now,
right.
we've got concentration about the top 80 mm-hmm. names, so it's not quite the same. So that's one thing that's a little counterintuitive.
The
Canadians.
Yeah.
The second that's a little counterintuitive to your argument you got is that there's also the effort to say, well, we really should treat them like utilities. Banks mm-hmm. should really be more utility-like. We're going to make them simpler. We're going to make them, you know, behave themselves, be like regulated utilities. Well, guess what? With a regulated utility, you end up regulating the rate of return.
Mm-hmm.
And we tend to look at the electricity, we look at, they get kind of concentrated when you treat them like utilities and set prices and set their rate of return. So I sure. feel there's still some tensions in this discussion that haven't been reconciled, but I'm curious about any of your reaction to my further
points. Can I just briefly, Canada is a very interesting example you brought up, but so if you talk to, and I've spent, you know, talking to people that regulate, so, yes, they have a very, very concentrated banking system. Yeah, they had a very mild, you know, financial crisis and things like that. Now, there are other things that help out, you know, because of that. But one thing that's fact is that, you know, the Bank of Canada, the regulator, sits on those eight banks, so how many, like an 800-pound gorilla, okay? So there's a trade-off. They have an implicit agreement, okay, that these eight banks is, we're going to give you some monopoly power, okay, that... You know, you're able to extract some rents, okay, by, you know, keeping deposits low and charging high premiums. You're very, you're much more profitable than you would be in another market. But in return is, you know, we have a very detailed look in your books. You will be financially stable, stuff like that. So in that sense, you know, that was, I think, part of the reason. The utilities, I don't think I'm supporting that argument. I'm just thinking is that, you know, to me, the argument of like these things, you know, that there's economies of scale, these things, you know, come up, that just doesn't seem to jive with empirical evidence.
Let me just pick up on Egon's point, which is I agree that the right way to go here, the right sort of theory of this, is to put capital charges that are essentially a relatively steeply increasing function of the size of the bank. You know, even if you sort of believe the research that says on average they're not economies of scale. First of all, that's a bit of a leap, but even if you believe it, that's an on average statement,
yeah.
right? So are there synergies in JP Morgan somewhere? What do I know? Maybe, quite possibly. So the last thing one wants to do as a regulator is actually make the decisions for them.
Right.
You know, you should divest this division or divest that. What you'd ideally like to do is essentially make it expensive to be large, charge the externality, and then let them choose. You know, if the activity is so synergistic that it creates enough value that you're willing to stay large, then you're, so all that seems to be the right theory of the case. I just want to mention one thing that's a bit of a missing piece, which is we have a little bit the idea that we're going to put these high capital charges, and then once they do it, well, the banks that are not kind of covering their capital costs will start to trade at a discount, and then market forces will cause them to break up. Okay, there's a little bit of a leap there, which is if you look at sort of the history of other large inefficient conglomerates, it's not usually the case that management goes, oh, I'm a large inefficient conglomerate, let me break myself up. Right? There's usually been the bringing to bear of some external force, whether it's hostile takeovers or activist investors or somebody who gets there and sort of rattles the cage. That's harder to do in banking, okay? There's a place where the regulators effectively really protect the banks from the market for corporate control. So one of my first briefings at the Fed was on something known as the source of strength doctrine. So if one of you guys has a private equity fund and you decide you or a hedge fund or whatever, you want to get on the board of Citi and you want to own a big equity stake, if that equity stake crosses a certain threshold, I forget what, 9.9% or something like that, you are deemed a source of strength. Means like you are responsible for the whole mess. And if something goes wrong with the bank, not just this investment, but your whole fund is essentially, it basically has the effect of making it uneconomic for a private equity investor to become an activist investor in a bank. So I like the idea of raising the capital charges, but I think if you really want that to get the ball rolling, you might have to get the Fed legal to look into like being a little bit more friendly to outside investors.
As a member of board of directors of a large insurance company, let me assure you a very flat yield curve may be doing what capital charges haven't.
Yes.
To both banks and insurance companies.
Business model, yes. Yeah.
Because in a very flat yield curve, it's very painful to run inefficient divisions. Anyway, one last question from you, ma'am, and then we'll be done.
Did you want
to get in on that? I'm sorry.
No, just actually briefly.
But no, bring the microphone down.
The regular, you know, money and banking arguments of what Egon actually said his story, you know, it was very interesting in hearing this. But I want to take again kind of the depositor side, which is that, you know, with the big banks, I think, you know, there is a different relationship, right? In that, I think there is a different model of banking. I think depositor have to be a lot more diligent, right? You lose, in a sense, potentially some of the incentive that came from that relationship.
Ma'am, you get the last word.
Okay. Hi, my question is, are we riding a technology bubble right now? If you know what I mean, like, are we overvaluing companies like Apple and so on?
That Fed calls it a question.
All right. Yes.
You know, I think we knew the answer to that.
Right. Peter,
I worked at an asset management company. That's a great question. It's a very, very hard one. Anyway, we've kept you all a little later. I want to thank you for coming, and I want to thank our panel for the terrific presentation.